I heard you went to Morocco.
Yeah.
To do a thing there. Explain what happened.
Well, we did a track with this North African piece, and we had this tribe of musicians called Jouka that many, many years ago, Brian Jones recorded, mm-hmm. and we put out this record on Rolling Stone's label. And they wrote to us and said, you know, we'd like to do some more things. The guy died, who was the head of the tribe, and his son had taken over, and he was younger, and he lived a bit in New York, and he wanted to get involved. So we said, that's a great idea for this piece, you know, so we went to Morocco and recorded them.
You recorded the entire song in Morocco?
No, we recorded the song, and then we recorded them playing along with it. They played strange pipes, and they have a mystical ceremony every year for this, which relives the ceremony of the pipes of Pan, which is a very old tradition. And we knew that these pipes would work very, very well over this track, so we did that.
I'm Bashir Attar, and I'm son of the Mr. Musician of Jouka. I'm Tik, my father's place, and this is the home of my father, music. I'm learning this music when I am about 4 years old, and you're welcome.
This is the other El Minza car, sweetie. Yeah.
Okay. Come here.
Yeah. Are we driving? Am I driving? No.
Can you pack the thing?
Yes.
All right.
And I'll see you down in the El Minza about
now.
Okay, put it in the other car.
Put it in the other car. Okay.
Throughout this century, the liberal and exotic atmosphere of Tangier has been a lure for Westerners seeking inspiration, adventure, and in some cases, refuge. Jack Kerouac made the journey in 1957, and a few years later, William Burroughs made several of these extraordinary home movies. Burroughs also wrote his most famous novel, The Naked Lunch, largely in Tangier. Gregory Corso and Allen Ginsberg joined the 50s Beat Party, But the uncrowned king of the expatriate artists was Paul Bowles, the American novelist and composer who had been living in Tangiers since the 30s. Bowles was one of the first Westerners to go up into the hills and hear the extraordinary music of Jouka. Before starting the recording session, Mick Jagger paid a visit.
Is it a long time since you've heard these Jouka people? It's a long time.
Except on tapes.
Yeah.
Yeah, I haven't been down there since... It was in the 50s. I went down with Brian, Geisen.
Geisen, yeah.
And, well, oh, Hamry.
Yeah.
Do you know Hamry?
I met him once, I think.
I think he's persona non grata in Jouka now.
Is he? What did he do? Yeah.
Oh, he went to London and picked up all the royalties for the album. It was supposed to be divided democratically in the village.
Because, did you go when Brian Jones went there? When Brian Jones went there?
He wasn't there when I was there, no. I was there before that.
Yeah, and that's the 50s, and he went there in, like, 67 or something.
Quite much later, yes.
Something like that, and then maybe it was earlier than that, but we put out the album, but he changed the sounds a lot of it. I mean, he did all kinds of strange things with it, processed it.
It comes in and out.
That's it, it's all phases. But that record's quite well known now in sort of a cult way.
Oh, yeah. I think it was quite quickly after it was issued.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Jouka is about 50 miles south of Tangier, in the foothills of the Rift Mountains. The musicians have traditionally been supported by the local people, and they have effectively acted as court musicians, playing at weddings and celebrations. There are festivals where they play for 10 hours at a time. Once a year, they reenact the rites of Pan in the festival of Boujolou, which embodies a mixture of fertility rites. The dancer dressed in animal skins represents Pan, who's held to have given the villagers the gift of music in return for a local woman. On finding out he had been tricked into accepting the village idiot, he cures her madness. Ever since, the village and the music of Jouka have been renowned as a cure for mental illness.
This scent is special for crazy people. Many people come here and we guard them like this, you know, and when they stay here about 1 month, or somebody is more sick, he can stay here about 2 months or 3 months. Few people they stay here. And this is the truth. When they stay here, they go and finish with the problems they have, or for crazy people. The people come from Europe, from England, directly to this sand. And the people come from America to here, to visit, because they listen about Saint Sidi Hamed Sheikh, what he mean. Because he's big Sufi who come to present the Islam in first here in this village. And he give the name for this village, Zahwan Ja'aka. Something coming good for you. The name of Jeju come in. Something good come to you.
The Jouka, they did have this sort of odd historical connection, which was kind of appealing somehow.
The Jouka.
Very tenuous, admittedly, but it did have a sort of... And there was this coincidental thing where... when I was writing this song that we're going to do this drumming on and playing pipes and so on tomorrow, I said, oh, this would be great if we could have someone like Jouka on it. And like the week after that, I got a letter from them saying, could we come and play on a show we did? So it was very coincidental, that part of it. But we sent them the tape, right? We sent the tape to Bashir. And, but it was in a very early state. There was no singing on it. There was no, nothing really except just the drum. So we've got to rehearse it tomorrow morning. So I don't know how quickly they can learn or whatever. Might take a while, what do you think?
Well, they've been practicing, haven't they?
I think so.
That's what I'm told. So I believe it.
We live in hope. But you're quite pessimistic about most things. You're quite pessimistic about most things.
About most things, yes. Yeah.